Well, today is an unofficial national holiday with the Super Bowl. And the question of that is go out to the stores. And I was out at the store last night out at Hy-Vee, and no little business happens for our proprietors locally. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I thank you for your goodness. God, I ask for your message to come through. Lord Jesus, I pray that you would help us to walk in the Spirit. God, I pray that you would help us to walk in dependence upon you. Thank you for your love, your goodness. Thank you for the music, the beautiful music, God, the voices, God, of the leaders and the congregation. God, we call upon you to help us today in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so we've been talking about walking in the Spirit here. I want you to fantasize with me for a second about something. You're sitting at home and you get a call. And it's from the President of the United States. I don't care, you know, what you pick your president. You're not a Trump guy and you're an Obama guy. You just pick them. Maybe it's, you know, you would loathe who it was, but if you just think of whoever your guy is. I'm going to use the example of Trump right now. Trump gives Jack Redmond a call. Says, Jack, President Trump here. I need you in Washington right now. There's not enough kindness in this world. I mean, people aren't even handing out candy to kids hardly at all. I need you to get here. We need to change the makeup of this country. I need you. I'm going to have Air Force One meet you over at Dubuque Regional Airport. Is that possible? We got an aviation specialist there just to verify that they could show up. What would you, you know, what would you do if you got the call? I'm telling you right now, I'd be like, yeah. Yeah. Hey, I won't be at work today. Got a call from the president. Well, if you don't show up, you're not gonna get paid. He said, "Don't worry about it. He's gonna cover me." Think about the purpose that we would have. He had great, whatever the purpose was, whatever value that he seen us, that we could direct to this country. You think of the power that he would have, and he would say, hey, whatever you need, the greatest leader in the free world would just say, whatever you need, I'll give it to you, you're empowered. And you think about the presence that you would have it, at your beckoning call, the president, all of his power, you would have that type of presence and prestige. My question to us is, do we have less purpose, less power, or less presence right now as a child of Jesus Christ? The answer is no. We do not. Now, I would still go to Washington. I want you to know that. I'd go. But we serve a great king. We are privileged people. We are a blessed people. And God calls us to higher living. He calls us to walk with him daily. Let's take a look at our review from last week. We're talking about walking in the Spirit. We are in Romans 8. Those who live according to the Spirit have their minds set on what that Spirit desires. Those who live according to the Spirit. And I say, hey, we covered that pretty thoroughly last week. We went over that several times last week, hey, that we need to live in the Spirit. But here is my question. It doesn't matter if we covered it last week. If we covered it here last week about walking in the Spirit, what really matters is, did we cover it last week by walking in the Spirit? Did we live moment by moment in the Spirit of God? Did we practice the presence of God moment by moment? If we have not, it is well worth our repeating and our reiteration. A Bible study, a time of studying in the morning, the Bible, or whenever you set your time, is like a sprint. A weekend retreat where we take some real extended time with God and we seek God for an entire weekend, we carve that time out, we just really seek God. Maybe we're at a conference or maybe a week-long conference. It's like a cross-country run or maybe a half marathon. A lifetime of practicing the presence of God is a journey. It's a walk. And that's what God calls us to. A quiet time is really good. It's really necessary. Weeks away, I encourage them for everybody. I try to do it every year at something that we do called Faith Walkers. It helps me to get away and refocus on God. God is not requesting a morning quiet time from us. He is not requesting a conference from us. God expects our life. He expects our moments. Every hour we need Him. Every hour. He calls us to walk in the Spirit. Sometimes walking with God will be like walking through Disney World, where this is a lot of fun. Look at the sights, look at the scenes. I am feeling good. Sometimes when we're walking through Disney World, we're just so in awe at the gifts that we forget the giver of the gifts and we walk ahead of God. Sometimes life is like that. And we got to remember to slow down. Hey, God has given us these gifts. This is great. Thank you, Jesus. I'm walking with you. I'm enjoying this, Jesus. Thank you, God. What do you have for me? Who do you have for me to talk to? Who do you have for me to bless? Other times, walking in the Spirit and walking with God is like walking through hell. We are discouraged. We are in despair. Our life is in turmoil. But I'm going to tell you, if you're walking through hell, don't stop. It's hot there. Keep walking. Keep walking. Your despair can discourage you. But God wants to be the Lord of our Disney World and the Lord of us walking through the valley of the shadow of death. He wants to be our very presence, moment by moment, You want to be our very presence. Sometimes those that you walk with Christ will quit walking. And it will be devastating for you as you watch them get off the path. And it breaks your heart and it discourages you because you're saying, wow, they're leaving the path of God. But you keep walking. You love them, but you keep walking. Don't quit. In our walk with Christ, we talk a lot about having a good Bible time. We need that. That is good. It's something we talk about a lot here. We can't even really talk about it enough. That we spend time in God's Word. But practicing the presence of God, walking in the Spirit of God, means that we want the God of the Word. We don't just want just the Word of God. Do you understand that the Pharisees had the Word of God, but they didn't have the God of the Word? We love God's Word because it's God's Word. Because we want God. We want His presence in our life. It's been said that character is the sum total of a lot of little choices. Our spiritual life is the sum total of a lot of little steps taken in submission to the Holy Spirit. Moment by moment, we submit to the Holy Spirit. We allow God, who is in us, to walk with us. We don't ignore Him, but we walk with Him. That's the spiritual person. The spiritual person walks with Christ and enjoys His presence and listens to Jesus. And does what Jesus tells them to do. It's a glorious thing to walk with God the Holy Spirit. He has such a beautiful, beautiful, amazing opportunity. Let's take assessment here. We analyze these verses here and just look at what camp do we want to believe in? We see the believer in the spirit and the unbeliever in the flesh. We'll talk a little bit more of defining the terms of flesh in a bit. The unbeliever walking after his sinful nature, what he does naturally. A believer lives by the spirit, he walks by the spirit. An unbeliever lives by the flesh. A believer has his mind set on God. An unbeliever's mind is set on self. A believer experiences life and peace. Whether they're walking through the valley or walking through times of glory, they experience life and peace. The unbeliever experiences death and anxiety. The believer submits to God's Word. The unbeliever ignores God's Word. The believer in the Spirit pleases God. The unbeliever that's not in the Spirit, look at that, is a very impactful thing. We need to look at both the negative and the positive. We cannot please God if we are walking after our sinful nature. We cannot. We need to look at both of our positive and our negative, both of the positive and negative things about walking with the Lord. Okay, so now we're We're moving along here. Romans 8. The theme of Romans chapters 6 through 8 is sanctification. Okay, I'll define that term. Okay. If you look at Romans 6 through 8, that theme is sanctification. Okay. Being sanctified means that we are being, as Christians, we are being set apart, okay, from the ordinary. It's like the president would call us, say, hey, yeah, I'm pulling you from your job. You're coming to the White House. I got something special to you. Well, God sets us apart, and he's got something special for us to do. We are his ambassadors. So to be sanctified, we are saved by God. We are filled with the Spirit. We are set apart, and now we got something special to do. And that's what it means to be sanctified, and that's what Romans chapter 6 through 8 is about. Romans chapter 8 is the climax of our sanctification. It is the culmination. Things are coming together, and it's now saying, wow, this is how you do it. This is what you do. So let's take a further look at this. You, however, are controlled not by the sinful nature, but by the Spirit, if the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to Christ. Let me make this very clear. When we receive Jesus Christ as our Savior, the Holy Spirit enters us. We are saved, and the Holy Spirit enters us. It's God in us. Jesus Christ died on the cross for all of our sins, for every sin that we will ever commit, past, present, and future. No matter what we would do to try to earn our way to heaven, if we went to church every day, if we did good things, no matter what we did, we could never earn our way to heaven. So God sent his one and only Son, Jesus Christ, into the world to die for our sins, to be a sacrifice for our sins. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him would not perish but have eternal life. So if you are here and you have never received Jesus Christ into your heart, you just simply need to look to Christ in your heart and say, Jesus, I understand that you died for my sins. I understand that I am separated from you because of my sins, and I receive you into my life and the payment that you made at the cross. Forgive all of my sins. Come into my life, and God will do that. And when he does that, he will indwell you with the Holy Spirit. If anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, your body is dead because of sin, yet your spirit is alive because of righteousness. So what are we talking about there? That your body, in verse 10, it says your body is dead because of sin. In Romans 7, what this is talking about here is our body of death. In Romans 7, verse 24, the Apostle Paul talked about this. The greatest mover and writer of the New Testament. Nobody has moved the kingdom of God and cooperated with the Spirit of God other than Jesus, like the Apostle Paul. And this is what the Apostle Paul said. He said, what a wretched man I am. What a sinful man I am. Who will rescue me from this body of death? I like this definition.
The flesh,
or the sinful nature,
is the tendency
that everyone with a body has. You have a body?
Okay,
then this applies to you. The tendency to be pulled back into sin. Everybody with a body has the tendency to be pulled back into sin. This is from Nelson's. I like this. This is from Nelson's New King James Bible here.
Talking about
verse 10 here.
Problem
that Paul is dealing with in this passage is how the dead body in which sin dwells can be made the vehicle for expressing the life of God. That is interesting, isn't that? The problem that Paul's dealing with in this passage is how the dead body, all of us that have bodies, have a tendency towards sin, in which sin dwells can be made the vehicle for expressing the life of God. Take further look at these passages here. You see the battle there in verse 10. But if Christ is in you, your body is dead because of sin, yet your spirit is alive because of righteousness. Because we receive Christ, we also have the spirit. We have this tendency towards sin, but we have the spirit of God in us. Well, we got to take inventory in these next verses, you guys.
They're so powerful,
they really almost need no commentary. But since I talk, I will provide some.
And if the spirit
of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, listen to that, Christian. If the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, that's not like, oh, well, Jesus is just living in you. Let's go on to the next topical point. It's like, oh, are you kidding me?
The spirit of Christ
that raised Jesus from the dead is living in us. Wow. You talk about power. You talk about overcoming power.
What can overcome
that power? That gravitational pull of sin in our life? The resurrection power of Jesus Christ living in us. That is pretty darn glorious. That is awesome. You talk about power. The spirit of him who raised Jesus Christ from the dead is living in you. He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who lives in you. Whoa. Lives in you?
That's
presence.
You talk about
power, and you talk about presence. I remember one of my dad's preachers,
Dr. Bob
Adams, powerful Baptist preacher, loved God. I remember him talking one time. There was a guy sitting in the front row, and he was preaching. And let me tell you, this guy could preach. And he's preaching about the Holy Spirit and Christ in him. This guy just kept going like this. And this is a church of like 2,000 people. Pastor Paul said, going on. He just kept going like this. He goes, what are you doing? After the sermon was over, hey, brother, what's going on? I want to remind myself where Jesus is. Right here. You think he's way out there? But for the believer, he's right here. That is more than a game changer. That is Christ in us. The hope of glory. your outline in Romans 8. First point would be there's no condemnation. Romans 8, 1 through 4. Second point would be there's no obligation.
Third point would be
there's no separation from those that love Christ. There's no separation. We can't be separated from the love of Christ. There's no obligation to the flesh. But there is an obligation. There is an obligation.
We are not condemned
people, but we are obligated people.
We take inventory
of what we have.
Christ
in us.
We're not condemned.
We're loved by God.
There's nothing we can do
to separate the love of Christ from us. What would that make us if we
receive
all of that and don't do anything with it?
Wouldn't that make us
just spoiled kids?
You got those parents
that are loaded with cash.
Here you go.
You want to go out to eat?
Here you go.
You want a $50,000 SUV? Here you go.
You want to go to college?
Here you go.
It's all yours.
Very generous. And then the kid says, I deserve this. How do you feel about that kid? I ain't good.
Listen,
I know somebody
with a very wealthy parent.
I have personal friends with him.
Lots of money.
CFO of a company. And I'll tell you what, he would always marvel. Because, man, he never let those kids know that they had money. And they had to earn it.
They were good kids.
If they ever needed something, they had their back or something too. So we knew they had their back. They're good kids.
God calls us
with this incredible wealth of spirituality that we have.
Calls us to a life of obligation.
It's perhaps more fun to say
there's no condemnation
for those who are in Christ than it is to say I am obligated to live for Christ.
But when we understand
the resources and who and what we have in Christ,
we are glad.
To be obligated to walk according to the Spirit of God that brings life. We are happy to walk with Christ.
You therefore, brothers,
we have an obligation.
But it is not to the sinful nature
to live according to it.
For if you live according to the sinful nature,
you will die.
If by the Spirit...
Here's our obligation here.
We have an obligation here.
Christian,
let's not catch this.
Let's fulfill our obligation.
Do we need this to be saved?
Uh-uh.
Does God still love us
if we don't do this?
Yep.
Why do we want to do it?
Because he loves us.
Because it's right.
Because we're free in Christ.
Because we're free in Christ.
We want to do this.
And we're going to do this.
And we're going to carry this out.
And what does he call us to do?
He calls us to put to death.
So the Spirit of God is the Spirit of life, right?
He's the Spirit of life.
We see that in Romans 8,
2, right?
Guess what?
Else the Spirit of God is.
He is also the Spirit of death.
and he wants to kill. He wants us to, with our participation, to kill in us the misdeeds of the body that grieve him. Do they separate us from him? No, but they grieve him. Will they keep us out of heaven? No. Will they keep us from being effective and attractive for the gospel of Jesus Christ? Yes.
Are we still
clean and holy and righteous if we grieve him? Yes. Because of what Christ did. Are we effective in this world? No. So God calls us to put to death the misdeeds of the body. What are the misdeeds of the body? The misdeeds of the body, that everything that doesn't look like Jesus Christ. Everything that doesn't look like Jesus. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. And if you struggle with anxiety, God calls you to put it to death. I do. Any of you struggle with loving people? You ever put yourself above somebody, some bum on the street? You're saying, well, in fact, I didn't, you know. You ever struggle with loving them? God calls you to put it to death. Are you a grump?
Seriously.
I mean,
do you wake up in the morning?
I'm working on this one. God bless my wife.
Seriously.
I'll tell you one thing. I got to put to death
is my relationship
with printers.
I can't print anything.
Johnny doesn't have a problem. My wife doesn't have a problem. I want to curse.
I was trying to print out my message today,
and I wanted to curse.
That is really paradoxical.
My wife is so faithful. She assures me it's operator error.
But it is the little things,
isn't it?
It's the big things
and the little things that God calls us to put to death.
We need to identify
what God wants us to put to death, and we need to put them to death.
Tell you what, when
we practice the presence of God, we walk with Jesus Christ moment by moment. We are led by God. He's just simply going to whisper and say, this is unattractive. Don't do this. And we say no.
You know, the just say no
campaign does not work.
Just say no
does not work
because
it doesn't give you any power to do it.
We need to say no
by the power of the Holy Spirit. We need help.
We need to say no
to sin and yes to God. And that is our living, walking, awesome relationship that we have.
What else do we put?
This is something I really want us to consider here. There are some things that we need to put to death in our lives that are probably very or somewhat obvious to others, but we are completely oblivious to. They are blind sights.
Sometimes
there's hurt and pain from our past and from choices that we've made that we just harden our hearts. And we just simply won't go and ask God to really expose our hearts, so we just hide them. And so we have heart problems that are unknown to us at times. And it's a mystery. And God calls us to do this. Some of these things take help. They absolutely take God, and they take His Spirit, and they take walking with God on a daily basis.
Put to death the misdeeds of the body,
you will live, because those who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. What is God going to lead you to? He's going to lead you to put to death the things of the flesh, the things that aren't attractive, the things that don't please God. He's going to lead you there if you listen. God calls us to listen.
For you did not receive a spirit that makes you a slave again to fear. And here we have a lot of the reason that we don't put things to death, the reason we don't go investigate those things that are not attractive, the reason that we're oblivious to them at times, because we're fearing something. We're fearing the exposure. So it's better to deny than to expose. So we have the answer. But you receive the spirit of sonship, and by him we cry, Abba, Father. You don't have to fear when you have the Father at your disposal that loves you, that doesn't condemn you. God will take care of you. And he will make it okay. And God will uncover what you need to kill in your body and what is unattractive for his glory. And he will release you from something that you have been plagued with for years. And you're thinking you're going to free fall because you're losing control. But guess who's going to catch you? It's going to be Abba. And that's a good place. Be caught.
The Spirit himself
testifies with our spirit that we are God's children.
Now, if we are children, then we are heirs of God
and co-heirs with Christ.
If we need to share in suffering, suffering doesn't make sense. Outside of the Spirit of living God, living in us. Outside of Abba Father. Outside of Jesus Christ. Outside of no condemnation. There is no condemnation in such relationship, with such purpose, with such power, and such presence.
Father, I thank you, God, for your great goodness to us, Lord. God, I pray for your spirit of comfort. Come to McDonough family every day, Lord. God, there are many hurting, needy people in our church, God. And in the city, God, we call upon you, the healer, God, to help us.